As far as the deviated sets are concerned, first the faculty of intellect and then the interpretation. And as far as the Ahlus Sunnah wal Jamaat are concerned, first interpretation in the light of the Quran and Hadith and then the faculty of intellect. If after interpreting a particular verse of the Quran or a hadith of our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam within the light of the Quran and hadith, the faculty of intellect is able to comprehend, alhamdulillah. And if the faculty of intellect is unable to comprehend, we say that the wahy overrules the faculty of intellect. The statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the statement of our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam overrules the faculty of intellect. Why? Because there are three sources of ilm. Source number one, the five senses. We are able to acquire ilm through touching. Sense number two, we are able to acquire ilm by seeing. Number three, we are able to acquire ilm through hearing. Number four, we are able to acquire ilm through smell. And we are able to acquire ilm through our tongue, through tasting. If we taste something, we will say, this is bitter, this is sweet. If we smell something, we will say, it is bad, it is good. And we see so many things. And as a result of seeing so many things, we acquire knowledge. And as a result of hearing, we acquire knowledge. And as a result of touching, this is smooth, this is rough, this is hot, this is cold, we acquire ilm. So the first source of ilm are the five senses. When we are young, when we are children, this is the source of ilm through which we acquire ilm. Number two, the faculty of intellect. When we grow older, then we acquire ilm through the five senses and also through the faculty of intellect. There are so many things that the eyes cannot perceive, the ears cannot perceive, the tongue cannot perceive, the nose cannot perceive, and our hands cannot perceive. Despite that, the faculty of intellect perceives. And we believe, for example, there is oxygen in this room. Our eyes cannot perceive that oxygen. Our ears cannot hear that oxygen. Our nose cannot smell that oxygen. Our tongue cannot taste that oxygen. And our hands and feet cannot feel that oxygen. Despite that, we all believe that there is oxygen in this room. This is knowledge. There is oxygen in this room. Somebody saying that I don't believe there is oxygen in this room. Why? Because the five senses cannot perceive it. What will be the answer? The answer will be, whatever the faculty of intellect perceives overrules what the five senses cannot perceive. We will all conclude that the faculty of intellect says that a human cannot survive without oxygen. And everybody here is alive. And if everybody is alive, that means there is oxygen in this room. So the knowledge acquired through faculty of intellect overrules the knowledge acquired through the five senses. Then there is a third stage, a more higher stage, which is wahi. And we say that just as the knowledge acquired through the faculty of intellect overrules and overrides the knowledge acquired by five senses, similarly, the knowledge acquired by wahy is greater than the knowledge acquired by the faculty of intellect. Therefore, the knowledge acquired by wahy will overrule and override the knowledge acquired by the faculty of intellect. So if a person says that my faculty of intellect cannot understand, it cannot comprehend, it cannot believe that intangible items will be weighed on the day of Qiyamah, we will say, but the wahi says it will be weighed. And if the wahi says it will be weighed, that means it will be weighed. Always remember, my friend, if there is agreement, the knowledge acquired through five senses, the knowledge acquired through the faculty of intellect, aql, and the knowledge acquired through wahy, they all agree, all three of them agree, it is acceptable. But if the knowledge acquired through five senses says something else, and the knowledge acquired through the faculty of intellect says something else. Whenever there is a clash between the five senses and the faculty of intellect, it is a 100% rule. The whole world believes this. Muslims, non-Muslims, everyone. That precedence will be given to the knowledge acquired by the faculty of intellect. And when there is a clash between faculty of intellect and wahy, the precedence will be given in all circumstances to the knowledge acquired by wahy. And although there are no groups in this day and age who claim to be Mu'tazila or Jahmiya or Murjiya or Karramiya, because of the materialistic world that we live in, these ideologies are creeping into our society. So it is very, very important for every believer to be submissive. Submissive. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us the whole sammakumul muslimin. Allah has given us the we are Muslims. Muslim. And who is a Muslim? A Muslim is he who submits. Whatever he hears from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he submits. And whatever he hears from his beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he submits. Whether the faculty of intellect accepts or not. There are so many examples in the lives of the Sahaba, Ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi wa jamein, but there is a very good example. During the Meccan life, when our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was invited by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he left Makkah Mukarrama and he traveled all the way to Baytul Maqdis. And from Baytul Maqdis, he was raised up into the heavens, and he visited Adam alayhi salatu wa salam in the first heaven, and Isa alayhi salatu wa salam in the second heaven, Yusuf alayhi salatu wa salam in the third heaven, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam in the fourth heaven, Harun alayhi salatu wa salam in the fifth heaven, Musa alayhi salatu wa salam in the sixth heaven, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam in the seventh heaven. He met all these great Anbiya alayhi salatu wa salam, and conversation took place. He spent a good portion of time in each heaven. And then he observed Al-Baytul Ma'mur. And after observing Al-Baytul Ma'mur, he went up to Sidratul Muntaha. And after Sidratul Muntaha, Jibril alayhi salatu wa salam stopped and he went alone. He went further alone. And then he saw Jannah, Jahannam, Loh, Qalam. And he communicated with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he returned to the sixth heaven with 50 salat. 50 salat. Command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to perform 50 salat. And Musa alayhi salatu wa salam asked him to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and ask him for a concession. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam meets Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again, and these things didn't happen in seconds. From the sixth heaven back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he returned with 40 salat. Musa alayhi salam appears again and he asks him to return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again. He returns again and he returns with 30 salat. He is made to return again and he comes back again, 20 salat, then 10 salat, then 5 salat, coming, going. And then he returns to Baytul Maqdis, and from Baytul Maqdis he returns to Hatim, and from Hatim he returns to the house of his cousin sister Umme Hani radiyallahu ta'ala anha, from where he had left. Such a long journey. It used to take approximately 1 month to travel from Makkah Mukarrama to Baytul Maqdis, to Jerusalem. And returning back would take 2 months. And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he wakes up in the morning, he tells the people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala invited me for Miraj. And during the night I traveled from the house of my cousin sister Umme Hani, I went into Hatim. I went to sleep in Hatim. Then I was woken up, and then I was taken by Jibreel and Mikael with many stops during the journey. And we finally reached Jerusalem, Baitul Maqdis. There all the Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam had gathered. I led the Salat. And we find in some narrations that after the Salat, the senior Anbiya alayhi salatu wasalam, Ibrahim alayhi salam, Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, they all spoke for a few minutes regarding the beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasalam. And then this long journey. When he returned, he says, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that when I returned to my cousin sister's home after this long journey, the door that I had left behind closing had not closed yet. It was still closing. For everybody the clock was moving. But for Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the clock was not moving. Now the faculty of intellect cannot comprehend this. One is time, and with all the new scientific information that we get, that when you reach a certain level, then there is a layer of fire. When you reach a certain level, there is no oxygen. So the faculty of intellect is, how is it possible? How is it possible? But we do not think with the faculty of intellect when it comes to wahi. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ, only those people deserve to be called true believers who believe in Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا, and thereafter do not doubt. So when people heard this story of Mi'raj from our beloved Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, some of them went very quickly to Abu Bakr Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. And they said to Abu Bakr Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, that Abu Bakr, is it possible for a person to leave Makkah Mukarramah, reach Jerusalem, and return from Jerusalem back to Makkah Mukarramah in one night? Not the journey of the heavens, only from Makkah Mukarramah to Jerusalem, and Jerusalem back to Makkah Mukarramah in one night. Is it possible? So Abu Bakr Siddiq رضي الله عنه said, no, it's not possible. But who says so? So they became very happy. So they said, your friend Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says so. So Abu Bakr Siddiq immediately said, if Muhammad says so, then it is possible. Faculty of intellect did not accept, because Abu Bakr, when he was asked, he said, no, it's not possible. But when he was told that this is the statement of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Bakr immediately said, then it is possible. Why? Because the wahy overrides and overrules the knowledge acquired through the faculty of intellect.